Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Vintage. Thank you to everybody who left comments on last week's video, which was for The Invoice by Jonas Carlson. I had three copies of that book to give away, and the lucky winners are AJ Boff, Nadia's Bookshelf, and No Butt. If you're one of those three lucky people, well done. You will find my email address at the bottom of this video's description. Send me your post address, and I'll get those books off to you as soon as I can. Now, this week, I'm talking about a classic. And if you have found this video because you're taking part in the 2016 Classics Challenge, hello, first of all. Welcome to the Vintage Vlog. I'm here every Friday talking about the one book that's really grabbed my attention, and this week it happens to be a classic. What I'll be doing, for those of you who don't know about the 2016 Classics Challenge, this is a sort of a challenge to read at least one classic each month through the year, and I've decided to take part two. I think it's a great way to talk about some classic books, even to discuss what makes a classic and all that kind of stuff. And of course, the only real problem is deciding which books to read. But the decision was quite easy for me for this first one because, well, there are two reasons. One, it happens to be the rediscovered classic at Waterstones this month. And one of the reasons why the book has got a bit of notoriety recently was because after the terrorist attacks in Paris, along with bunches of flowers on the streets, a book started to appear. And this is because somebody giving an interview had said that it was important to read this book. And that is because it is all about Paris. It's all about the spirit of that city. And it is written by somebody who was not a Parisian, but happened to live there at a particular period. And it was sort of almost a gesture of defiance. People were putting this book along with a bunch of flowers on the streets to sort of say how much they loved their city. This is the book, A Moveable Feast by Ernest Hemingway. There was another very good reason for me to read this book, and I probably have to lower my voice while saying this, given that I work at Vintage. I've never read any Ernest Hemingway. I don't know how that's happened. I know that I've got some Hemingway at home on the shelf, but it remains on the shelf and I've never read it. So I had to sort of break my duck. I had to read some Hemingway because I knew I would probably like it. I just don't know why I hadn't. So anyway, A Moveable Feast turned out to be my first Hemingway and I did love it. And I'll tell you why. There are many reasons why. For those who don't know, A Moveable Feast is not a novel. It is a memoir that he wrote towards the end of his life. It was about the 60s when he wrote it. He was living in Cuba, but he's writing about the period that he spent in Paris, which was roughly sort of 1921 to 1926. So we're talking about 1920s Paris, which of course probably conjures up in your head already some lovely images. And it is about him as a writer and about sort of, I guess, living, I was going to say cafe society, but that's not really what he was doing because actually, as you read the book, you know, he's talking often about having no money or not very much money and trying to sort of scrabble pennies together from various bits of writing and bits of jobs that he was doing everywhere to have enough money to eat, you know, reasonably well. And of course, in the Paris of the 20s, you didn't need much money to be able to drink a nice bottle of white wine and have some nice food. And he does spend a lot of time in cafes, but as a writer. And I think if you are a writer, if you have any pretensions to being a writer, you're going to love this book because there's a lot of stuff in there about being a writer, about sitting there with a notebook on your desk and a pen in your hand and trying to work out where the next word or phrase or sentence is going to come from. There's some really good quotes in there, some really good advice to writers, one of which is this thing about sitting down and just trying to write one true sentence as a means of getting things started. And then you write another one and then another one. He has a great work ethic in this book. So if you need a bit of chivying along with your writing, it's another good thing to read. Of course, the reading time will take away from your writing time, but don't worry, I'm sure it'll pay back some way. It's also great about Paris, of course, as you would expect. You can feel yourself sat in a Parisian cafe with a disgustingly high tar cigarette and an equally disgustingly dark black coffee and, you know, really soaking up that atmosphere. And also he's surrounded by other figures, which their names are sort of casually dropped, you know, Gertrude Stein and F Scott Fitzgerald, you know, just sort of those names just dropped very casually. But, you know, that's sort of a mark of what was going on in Paris at that time. You know, he's spending time with those people. It's a great description of him reading an early draft of The Great Gatsby and knowing straight away that this was a knockout book. But the sort of the caveat to that is that he can see that F. Scott Fitzgerald himself is a bit of a mess and he's got a very strange relationship with his wife. And, you know, there's a lot of alcoholism going on in Paris in the 1920s, probably Ernest Hemingway included. But, you know, it's just sort of really a fascinating insight into those characters and into Hemingway himself and into a society in a, you know, very particular place at a very particular time. And it just feels very nourishing as you read it. You know, you really soak up a lot of atmosphere And as I say, I think as a reader and as a writer in particular, if you are, there's a lot to enjoy there. There's another thing as well, like he describes going to the famous Shakespeare and Company bookshop, and he has no money to buy books, but the woman who runs it lends him books. There's something very, I think, just very wonderful about that love of books that really comes through this one, so that people are willing to sort of lend books to a burgeoning writer in order to support them, because they know that it's important, that, you know, what's being offered there is some kind of spiritual nourishment. Of course, I like to do the same here by giving away copies of books every week. And I have 3 copies of A Moveable Feast to give away. So if you think that it's something that you'd be interested in reading, maybe adding to your 2016 Classics Challenge if you're taking part, then make sure you're a UK-based subscriber, make sure you're subscribed, and leave a comment below, and I will pick 3 people to win a copy of A Moveable Feast next week. Next week I'll be talking about something, again, completely different. I'll be talking about books, actually, a couple of books which are about reading rather than writing. So there'll be a lot to talk about there, actually, with 2 books. They're very different, but both really, really interesting. So I hope you will join me next week. But until then, that's all for this week. Take care.